Ah, ben bienvenue pour cette reprise de ce séminaire qui a débuté en janvier et qui porte donc sur le patrimoine spolié pendant la période du nazisme et sur la recherche de provenance à l'échelle internationale. Donc je suis ravie de vous revoir, beaucoup de têtes que je revois qui sont déjà fidèles depuis le début et je suis très contente de vous présenter ce soir. Notre intervenante qui est venue d'Amsterdam. Mais avant de présenter donc Mara Lagerveij, je voudrais profiter d'un tout petit moment pour vous parler 2 minutes de notre projet que je dirige ici à l'INHA et qui est un projet en fait de recherche en coopération avec la Technische Universität de Berlin, donc l'Université technique de Berlin, et qui porte, comme vous le savez, je pense la plupart de vous, qui porte sur un répertoire des acteurs du marché de l'art sous l'occupation. Donc en fait, notre travail consiste à dépouiller des archives en Allemagne et en France pour essayer de faire, en fait, créer une base de données sur les acteurs pour montrer les réseaux en fait, des personnes qui étaient actives sur ce marché de l'art. Et j'en parle 2 minutes là ici à l'entrée de ce séminaire, puisque je viens d'avoir la bonne nouvelle quand vous savez qu'on a tous besoin des personnels et c'est toujours très difficile. Moi, je suis la seule personne qui dirige ce projet ici à l'INHA et j'ai une collègue qui travaille également quasiment seule à Berlin. Donc, on est souvent soutenu par des formidables stagiaires, mais sinon, le travail est parfois un peu difficile parce qu'il y a beaucoup de choses à faire. Et je viens d'apprendre que j'aurai la possibilité d'engager un moniteur. Pour la durée d'un an, peut-être renouvelable une fois. Donc, il y aura l'offre qui sera publiée sur le site de l'INHA. Mais si vous êtes un étudiant en master, parce que ça s'adresse aux étudiants en master, et si vous êtes intéressé par ce genre de recherche, bon, voilà, je vous sollicite en fait de postuler. Donc, c'est un travail à mi-temps qui est compatible avec des études en master, de préférence histoire de l'art, mais ça peut être aussi plus vaste. Ça peut être des études en Sciences Po, en droit, bien sûr, avec un point fort histoire de l'art. Enfin, on en parlera. Je vous signale juste que l'appel d'offres sera publié dans les jours à venir. Donc, voilà, si vous êtes intéressé ou si vous connaissez des jeunes étudiants intéressés par ce sujet, voilà, ça serait formidable de penser à nous. Voilà, donc pour aujourd'hui, je suis ravie donc d'accueillir Mara Lagerveij qui est venue donc d'Amsterdam aujourd'hui. Elle travaille au Rijksmuseum depuis un moment déjà. Elle est historienne de l'art de formation. Elle a fait d'abord un bachelor en études culturelles à l'Université d'Amsterdam, qui a été suivi par un master pareil en études plutôt assez globales, études culturelles et l'histoire de l'art, à la même université. Et son travail de master portait en fait sur un sujet tout autre, sur le travail du peintre et photographe hollandais Georg Hendrik Breitner, qui a travaillé à la fin du 19e, début 20e siècle. Alors, comment est-elle arrivée dans la recherche de provenance? En fait, elle a fait un stage au Rijksmuseum en 2010. Pendant ce stage, elle a principalement travaillé sur une collection de catalogues de peintures du XVIIe siècle. Et suivie par ce stage, en fait, elle s'est spécialisée dans ce domaine. Elle a eu la chance, en fait, d'avoir été embauchée directement pendant qu'elle était encore étudiante en master par le Rijksmuseum en tant que chercheuse de provenance. Alors, principalement, dans un premier temps, elle a travaillé sur les collectionneurs, l'histoire des collectionneurs 17e, 18e et 19e siècle, toujours liée donc à la collection du musée. Et donc, ça fait maintenant, je n'ai pas grand-chose d'autre à dire, mais ça fait déjà 7 ans, effectivement, que tu as cette expérience en tant que chercheuse de provenance au sein de ce grand musée d'Amsterdam. Et on est ravis aujourd'hui parce qu'elle va nous présenter donc à la fois son propre travail, bien sûr, mais aussi le travail de cette équipe, parce qu'ils ont une grande équipe de conservateurs, elle va nous en parler, au sein de ce musée qui est exclusivement, leur travail est exclusivement dédié à la recherche de provenance. Et elle va également, je pense, nous parler, ça serait plutôt dans la deuxième partie, la partie de discussion de la situation aux Pays-Bas, comment le gouvernement, comment est la politique en fait de recherche de provenance. Mais bon, ce soir, c'est vraiment le focus sur l'équipe ou son travail au Rijksmuseum. Et on est ravis aussi parce que c'est une grande première puisqu'elle nous parlera en anglais. Donc c'est bien parce que ça nous change aussi. Donc le sujet est quand même recherche de provenance à l'échelle internationale. On a eu la chance, les premières séances, d'avoir des intervenants souvent bilingues ou d'origine française. Mais bon, quand on travaille sur ces sujets, bien sûr, à un moment donné, il faut passer à l'anglais. Donc on est ravis que ça se passe ce soir en anglais. Et par contre, elle comprend très bien le français. Elle parle aussi très bien. Donc si vous avez après des questions en français, évidemment, il n'y a aucun problème pour la question linguistique. Voilà. Merci Mara et bienvenue.
Alors, ça marche? Bonsoir à tous et merci Inès pour cette gentille introduction et l'invitation. Et merci pour donner-moi l'opportunité de parler et raconter ce soir de notre recherche à la Rijksmuseum et spécialement la recherche de Mannheimer. Et pardonnez-moi, mais maintenant je vais changer à anglais. Okay, so first I will tell you something about the structure of my talk. I will give a short introduction into the provenance research we do in the Rijksmuseum, and like Ines already said, in the end, maybe in a discussion, we can talk even more broadly about provenance research in the Netherlands, but tonight I will focus on our museum and a special research on Mannheimer, Fritz Mannheimer. I will tell you about the journey of the collection, where were these objects before, during, and after the war. I will tell you about the most important sources we made use of during our research. I will tell you about Mannheimer's personal life, his biography, before and during the Third Reich, Mannheimer as a collector, and the results of our research. And then in the last part, I would like to talk with you about what it means to be transparent, what it means to be open, what that means in our museum, and maybe in the discussion we can talk about it more together. In 2009, the Museum Association in the Netherlands asked museums to investigate the provenance of their collection. The aim was to compile an inventory of objects of which the provenance suggests possible theft, confiscation, sale under duress, or other suspicious circumstances between 1933 and the end of the Second World War. These investigations into museum acquisitions from 1933 onwards focuses exclusively on art and Jewish ritual object, Judaica, in Dutch museums. 3 years after, a little bit late, in 2012, the Rijksmuseum appointed a team of provenance researchers as part of the Dutch National Research Museum acquisitions from 1933 onwards, it's called, with a very long title. Focus of this research is to establish whether any of the objects acquired by the museum between 1933 and 2012, when we started, and created before 1946, have questionable provenances during the time of the Third Reich. Hereby, the guidelines of the national project are applied, and one aims to clarify the provenance transactions during the critical years in order to rule out or identify any outstanding losses due to Nazi persecution. Given the extent of the Rijksmuseum's collection, which I will tell you about more, this provenance is carried out in phases in our museum. As you can see, at the moment we have a team of seven. We once started with four, we were with two for a while, but now actually we are with seven, which is quite incredible. And We are the only museum in the Netherlands who has such a big team. In most museums, only one or sometimes two provenance researchers are working, but most of the time it's part of the job of the curator as well. And I have to say, it's such a privilege to work in a team this big, and you must know as researchers yourself how wonderful it is to help each other and review each other's work. And we are also extremely lucky that the board of directors of the Rijksmuseum, with our head director, Taco Dibbets, acknowledges fully the importance of provenance research and has funded this research from the museum's own income already for 7 years. Or the first year was paid for by the government, but after, the museum pays for everything. The way we do research, our normal method, is mostly when we start with a group of objects, with a collection, for example, the paintings, we first look at all the internal sources we have, such as inventory books, our own archive, letters from directors, so we make like a complete overview of what we have in the museum. Then we focus on former owners. For example, if you find that a collector donated 50 drawings in 1 year to the Rijksmuseum, but his whole collection was already complete in the 1920s, you're done. So it's always good to start with the former owners. And then we, in the third phase of our research, we focus on the objects, and this is where we do the extensive literature research. We check all the Waterloo databases on the internet, we go to external archives, etc. So far, in these 7 years, we've completed the research on almost 12,500 objects. And you have to imagine that like the average pace on which you can do research is about 2.5 objects a day. It's really hard to plan, of course, scientific research, but we try to do that as much as we can. So far, this resulted in 18 paintings that might have a problematic provenance, 2 silver objects from the Boetke collection, and 185 objects from the Mannheimer collection that I, of course, will tell you about later. We are currently working, actually, like the Mannheimer research has kind of been an example in our approach because we decided to do this research earlier because we knew there were problematic objects in it. And now we kind of made a whole group of possible risk groups, and we are working on that now. So we do all the acquisitions between 33 and 45 for all parts of the collection. And what we still have to do in total is about 70,000 objects. And the coming 4 years, these risk groups will be about 10,000. And I also show you this vast number of objects that still lay ahead of us to keep in mind when we discuss later openness and transparency at the end of this talk, because I want to talk about what can we do. Like, we have to do this research thoroughly and at a high quality, but we also want to be open where we stand, and can and should we do more in terms of visibility of the research? How can we start telling stories, the provenance research revealed already, and start a dialogue while continuing the day-to-day provenance research? Now I will continue this talk with a special case study that me and my colleague Merel van Erp, who unfortunately couldn't be here today, and I worked for almost 2 years. The provenance research on works in the former collection of Dr. Fritz Mannheimer. The decision to look into this collection separately issued from the fact that Dr. Mannheimer acquired many objects in German and occupied areas between 1920 and 1939. Accordingly, there's a risk that he purchased objects whose provenance is unclear or were in forced sales. It is very important, I think, to stress that during this 2 year research, we could only do the part of the Mannheimer collection that is now in the Rijksmuseum. So we, like Mannheimer, collected more, and not all his pieces ended up in our museum, but this was the main focus on our collection, the Dutch part. And that is all the objects that stayed in his house in Amsterdam and are nowadays part of our collection. We unfortunately did not have time to conduct a larger research on his collection as a whole. nor could we research Dr. Mannheimer's biography more thoroughly, but it would be very worthwhile to still do a complete research someday and combine archival sources from Germany, Netherlands, England, Russia, and France, and try to reconstruct his entire collection in order to form a more complete image of this man and his important collection. The Jewish Dr. Fritz Mannheimer was born in Stuttgart in 1819. After living in Berlin, he moved to Amsterdam in 1915. He bought a villa at number 20 Hobbemastraat, and this is a building exactly across from the Rijksmuseum. And here we see a photo from 1920 when he bought it with a more recent photo, and which is a funny fact is that now in this building are the offices of the Rijksmuseum, and actually the office of our director is on the corner room on the first floor. So in the old house, so he's so closely connected to us, I feel. Then I will tell you first a little bit about the journey of the collection. How did it end up in our museum, or at least such a big part? Before the war, of course, it was collected by Mannheimer in Amsterdam, but also in Vaucresson in France, where he also had a house. And then I will come back to this part of the story later. During the war, however, first I have to tell you something else, sorry. In 1920, Mannheimer was made responsible for establishing the Amsterdam branch of the Berlin Mendelssohn Bank, and he began collecting around that same time. Mannheimer financed his acquisitions with money from his Amsterdam branch, and his collection would be famed for its enormous scope, exceptional quality, and rich history. On 25 June 1934, this is a bit of a technical part, but Mannheimer transferred his ownership of the art collection to an English firm that was formed by the bank, and it's called Artistic and General Securities Companies, and they became the formal owners of the collection. But the art was given to him on loan so that it could remain in his house, so he kind of had it in usufruct. It's not really sure, but some sources say that they said he should stop collecting, but he didn't do that, and he kept collecting until his death in 1939. In the final years of his life, Mannheimer suffered health problems, and from the end of 1938, he was cared for by Marie-Annette Reis. The two married in 1939, and following Mannheimer's death that same year, she gave birth to their daughter, Anne Frans Mannheimer. Due to outstanding debts of his estate, it was declared bankrupt shortly after his death, and legal expert Korthals Altes was appointed trustee administrator of the financial affairs. By order of Korthals Altes, Miss Hudig, who was a curator of decorative art in the museum, drew up an expert valuation list in 1939, that I will show later, of all the objects that she found in the Hobbemastraat 20. So this is important to know that this was not Mannheimer's only house, and he had a villa in Vaucresson, but the list she made, it is all the possessions that were in the Hobbemastraat 20. This means that also the parts that are in the Rijksmuseum now are from this part of the collection. It is not known exactly what kind of collection was housed in Vaucresson. It is clear, however, that several drawings and one painting now also in the Rijksmuseum collection were from this French part and came into German possession too in the Second World War. In 1940, the art in the Hobbema mansion was sold to the Dienststelle Mühlmann for around 5.5 million guilders. In 1940, the Austrian art historian Dr. Cajetan Mühlmann set up an office in The Hague, which functioned as a clearinghouse for art expropriated during the occupation of the Netherlands. This agency became known as the Dienststelle Dr. Mühlmann. In 1941, he wrote, "Unter den private Kunstsammlungen in der Niederlande ist die ehemalige Sammlung Mannheimer die vielseitigste und hervorragendste." And here he says that it's the most important art collection. And in this photo, we see Mühlmann in the Wiener Hofburg in March 1938, where Joseph Goebbels on the left is welcoming actors while Mühlmann listens. with Gertrude Seyss-Inquart, who was the wife of Seyss-Inquart, who was the leader, the NS leader of the Netherlands, on his right, and Paula Wesley on the left side. We know from sources and archival material that Alois Miedel, who was acting on behalf of Göring, had also been very interested in buying the collection and was pushing Mühlmann to sell. Parallel, however, the collection came to the attention of Hans Possem, who was the Sonderbeauftrager, who was in charge for to fill Hitler's to-be-built museum in Linz. Here we see scale models of this museum that was actually never realized. And Possem wrote this clear letter, Überweisung einer Anzahl erlesener Meisterwerke aus der vom Reich erworbene Kunstsammlung Mannheimer beehre ich mich zu berichten, dass der Führer ausdrücklich den gesamten, jetzt in Stift Hohenfurt untergebrachten Bestand der Sammlung Mannheimers für Linz bestimmt hat. And with this message, Miedel's possibility to buy was understandably directly over, since Hitler's choice was always outweighed that of other NS leaders. The remaining objects that were not selected for the to be built Führer Museum were divided over three Amsterdam auction houses and sold in 1941. After the war, the Mannheimer collection was recuperated to the Dutch state. The majority of the Mannheimer collection was transferred to the Rijksmuseum, which continued to set the tone in the present museum collection, actually. We have permanently on display, like the whole Rijksmuseum collection contains 1.2 million objects, from which 8,000 are permanently on show, and close to 500 are from the Mannheimer collection. So it says something about the importance of this collection, and it's actually the reason the Rijksmuseum can compete on an international level in their foreign decorative art. And not all objects, what you see here as well is in 1950, in the Rijksmuseum, there was a big show with all the recuperated art where people could come and look and if they could recognize pieces. Not all objects ended up in the Rijksmuseum. From 14 to 21 October 1952, a large amount of 476 lots of Mannheimer recovered collection were auctioned off at Frederik Müller, an auction house in Amsterdam. And whenever you come across, maybe when you work for a museum and you come across a Mannheimer object, it's always good to look at this catalog to see if you can find back your object. We have it in our library, so you can always contact me and see. I can look if it's in there. I do it quite a lot for people. In addition, a number of different objects that were not in the sales were also parceled out among various other Dutch museums. Then, like with all research, we first had to look at our sources, because the big thing with the Mannheimer research is that there's no archive of Mannheimer himself, and many people have looked for it, but so far it seems lost or destroyed, or we don't know. So actually all the proof you can find has to come from circumstantial evidence. And a very, very helpful tool proved to be a photo album. This album of the interior of Mannheimer's mansion on Hobbemastraat 20 is part of the Rijksmuseum collection, and it was datable to 1928 to 1933, and it was made by a Jewish-German photographer, Hannah Elkan. She was born in Berlin in 1893, and she established herself in Amsterdam from 1928 and opened a studio at the Van Baerlestraat, that's near the concert building and the museum square, and also very, very close to the Mannheimer mansion. An important clue to date the album was that the donor of the album, Mr. Jaffe, indicated that he received the album as a gift from Dr. Mannheimer around 1930, and additional research confirmed this. The album consists of 52 photographs of various rooms, including their furnishings and decoration, in which individual objects could be clearly identified, like this. So it was really like a detective work to look at all these photos and see which of the pieces are nowadays in our collection, because it means that they were in the in the collection before 33. Another important source was the collection catalogue that was written in 1936 by Otto von Falke. And this is, for example, terracotta that was first attributed to La Robbia. And it is described like this in the catalogue, and which is really, really helpful is that the catalogue is very precise on the provenance information. So here it says, catalogus Raoul Heilbronner, and he was an art dealer and also a cousin of Mannheimer. So then you know like what is the latest source before Mannheimer got it into his collection. Then I will show you a piece of the valuation list that was made by the curator Miss Hudig that I mentioned before. And it was the result of the inventory and valuation of the Mannheimer collection commissioned after his death by the trustee administrator charged with settling the bankruptcy. Already in 1934, the art collections were transferred to Artistic, and the administration surrounding this transaction, however, remains unknown to this day. In the archives of the district court in Amsterdam, it is noted that the transaction, during the transaction, there was made use of a list from 1925, but never in our research we could find this list. But luckily, we did have the Hudig list because she mentions, here the number Artistic. So we could link it to the Artistic numbers. And here again on the bottom, you see this is the same, the La Robbia altar that is being, the retable that is being described in the collection catalog. All objects with an Artistic number only have a gap in the period January 1933 and June 1934. So summarizing these three sources, they could tell us at which point in time an object already was part of the Mannheimer collection. If an object was in the photo album, it was already in his collection before 1933. If it had an Artistic number, before 1934. And finally, it was mentioned in the collection catalog, it is at least must have been part of the collection by 1936. Like I told a little bit before, the Jewish Dr. Fritz Mannheimer grew up in Stuttgart, where his father, Max Mannheimer, owned a wine shop. After high school, he studied law at the University of Heidelberg. And in 1915, he moved from Berlin to Amsterdam to work for the Mendelssohn & Co. Bank. On this photo, we see him with his only brother, Victor, and the wife and child of Victor. And this photo was taken in 1919 by the photographer Merkelbach, who owned a very well-known portrait studio of the time. There's also a wonderful website from the City Archive where you can see all the portraits from the Merkelbach studio. And there were many, many Jewish people who were deported after that were photographed by this studio. And we know that this photo was taken on the Kloveniersburgwal, 113, so that was the house he lived in before he moved to the Hobbemastraat. Then I wanted to show you two small fragments from, like, it's very interesting that this still exists, but from two black and white movies where you can see Mannheimer on holiday, but I have to, it's not working in the presentation, but I can show you separately. And here you will see like a man with round glasses dancing, and that is Mannheimer. So I will show you a short fragment. It comes after this. Here you see Mannheimer. In this video, we see Mannheimer on holiday in Italy around 1930. Unfortunately, nothing more is known until now about all the other people in the video, or at least it wasn't researched. But the images do give a sense of the time, social class, and atmosphere Mannheimer moved in. Mm-hmm. Yes. The mansion on the Hobbemastraat 20 that Mannheimer moved into was situated next to the museum square. For you who've been to Amsterdam, you probably know where it is. It's also where the Rijksmuseum, the Van Gogh and the Stedelijk Museum are situated. Several industrials and art collectors such as Otto Lanz and Baron Willem Frederik van Heukelom also lived at that time in the museum square, so it must have been quite a cultural area. And the purchase of this villa by the German banker was even mentioned in the newspaper. And perhaps it was because he bought it for an enormous price of 700,000 guilders at the time. Mannheimer's other home was in Vaucresson, a quiet town outside of Versailles, and it's known that he felt much more in place there, and he preferred spending the most time at the end of his life in Vaucresson. Mannheimer was really part of the high society of his time, and he had contact with various members of the Rothschild family, Coco Chanel, and an actress and interior designer, Elsie de Wolf, who was also known as Leni Mendel. And Mannheimer asked her to do the decoration of the Villa Monte Cristo that he owned in Vaucresson. And this is the house where he would also pass away in 1939. As head of the Amsterdam branch of the Berlin Mendelssohn Bank, Mannheimer became a well-known banker. And in the 1920s, the Mendelssohn Bank in Amsterdam became one of the five biggest banks in the Netherlands. Mannheimer was known for his extraordinary lifestyle. He lived a luxurious life. He drove through the city in a Rolls Royce with a chauffeur and gave large parties at his house. As a collector, he was one of the few that could compete on the art market with collectors like Calouste Gulbenkian, Andrew Mellon, and Isabella Stewart Gardner. The Amsterdam and Dutch people, however, did not appreciate this abundant lifestyle of Mannheimer, and he was confronted with heavy anti-Semitic criticism. In this 1941 anti-Semitic pamphlet, four pages are completely focusing on Mannheimer and his assumed bad character, and it's really shocking to read. When Mannheimer wanted to become a Dutch citizen in 1936, he received again a lot of critical notes. The government, but also public media, received letters from people that were against Mannheimer receiving the Dutch nationality. Despite the fierce criticism, Mannheimer eventually did become a Dutch citizen, and this was partly made possible by the Minister of Education, Art and Science, who stood up for Mannheimer by saying, "Wie aan de weg timmert als deze aspirant landgenoot en wiens leven dan nog langs alle wegen wordt nageplozen, komt tegenover de eisen voor naturalisatie geheel anders te staan dan een gewone sterveling. Hier is niet gelijkheid, doch ongelijkheid van behandeling," which means that he was treated in a much different way than any normal person that would ask for to become a Dutch citizen. Recently, more attention has been paid to Mannheimer's attempt to financially help German Jews in several European countries. This book by Sylvie Bailly was published only a few months ago in April of this year. In this book, more information can be found on Mannheimer's efforts to help, especially the French government, to create, even before the war, a more stable economy, and by doing so, trying to avoid falling into fascist hands. Research already before shows Mannheimer resisted the Nazi Party and was able to help collect money in order for German Jews to flee the country because of his many business relations, like the one with his friend Robert Bosch from the Bosch Company, you probably know. Courthals Altes, the before-mentioned financial administrator of the Mannheimer inheritance, describes how Mannheimer used the unlimited credits he could pull out of the Mendelssohn & Co. Bank, of which we see a photo here, in order to donate and support those who were suffering from Nazi persecution. In 1935, he tried to form an alliance with contacts from the financial world to collect funds for Jews and even wrote a letter to the British government for help. In this letter, he wrote, "I am writing you this letter not only as a Jew, but as a man of liberal ideas and ideals, and in the fear that the example set by the German government might find an echo elsewhere, and that the human rights for which our ancestors suffered and fought might be superseded by a return to a reign of barbarity darker than the one in the Middle Ages." a very foreseeing mind. Then I will tell you something about Mannheimer as a collector. Here we see Mannheimer's house on the top left, where we can recognize again the terracotta that we saw earlier, that was attributed to La Robbia. In the context of that of the interiors of contemporary collectors in the Netherlands, like Otto Lans and Catalina von Panwitz. And you could say that at least our curator of decorative art, Rainier Baars, always says this was a little bit an old-fashioned German interior at the time. And it's likely that Mannheimer changed his darker German interior shortly after this album of Hannah Elkan was made, because when we look at the acquisitions that we know he did after 1936, it seemed that he changed his style and he collected more lighter pieces. You can see it already a little bit. These are all photographs from the Hannah Elkan album still on the top floor. And Mannheimer was influenced by the international elite of the time and the preferred so-called Guy Rothschild. He was also in contact in the Netherlands with members of the Rothschild family. And here you see the interior of What is the Manor, the Rothschild house in Buckinghamshire, not far from London. And you can see really how Mannheimer decorated his house in that style. The most important sources for acquisition I will talk about now. Mannheimer purchased most of the objects from private individuals or international dealers, but he also bought from German museums and owned many objects from nationalized Russian state collections. Mannheimer acquired objects from Jewish collectors who were persecuted by the Nazi regime. And two of those examples I will now highlight in short. The Mannheimer collection includes 43 inventory numbers whose last known owners are given as the Jewish Hanna Mathilde Freifrau von Rothschild, her son-in-law, or one of her grandchildren. Hanna Mathilde died already in 1924, and it is possible Mannheimer bought objects from her directly before the Nazi regime came to power. The theory that Mannheimer had these objects in his collection at least early is supported by the fact that all of the objects have an artistic number, which means they were definitely in his possession by 1934. The daughter of Hanna Mathilde, Minna Caroline von Rothschild, married Maximilian Benedict Heum Goldschmidt. They had three sons, Albert Max, Rudolf and Erich von Goldschmidt Rothschild. When the Nazi regime came into power, the Goldschmidt-Rothschild family suffered increasingly from the anti-Jewish decrees. The family had only limited access to their assets and were forced to pay exorbitant taxes. In 1935, Albert Max von Goldschmidt-Rothschild sold Schloss Grüneberg, the stately home in Frankfurt where he had lived after his grandmother. In 1938, his father, Max Benedict, also sold his home, his Goldschmidt Rothschild Palace at 10 Bockenheimer Landstraße in Frankfurt. After the Kristallnacht, the Frankfurt city government increasingly appropriated Jewish property. In 1938, Max Benedict sold his valuable art collection of approximately 1,400 objects under duress to the city of Frankfurt. In 1938 and 1939, Rudolf Max and Albert Marx respectively fled Germany, for which a sum of hundreds of thousands of Reichsmarks had to be paid from the family capital as flight tax. You call this Reichsflugsteuer. They fled to Switzerland, where Albert Marx died in 1941. The old father stayed in Frankfurt and died in 1914 at the age of 96. Thorough research, as you can imagine, was conducted into the object from the collections of Max Benedict von Goldschmidt-Rothschild and his sons. Because they were all living in Germany at the time of the Nazi regime. After extensive research, the provenance of one object has been classified as probably problematic because it is certain that Max Benedict had it still in his collection in 1935. As for the other objects owned by this family, however, to date no proof has been found that many pieces had not left their ownership before 1933. But it's also possible some objects stayed in their collection longer and they had to sell these pieces because of the incredible taxes they had to pay in order to escape. Another enormous collection in the possession of Mannheimer is that of the couple Hans and Margarete Oppenheimer. Little is known about the Berlin Jewish couple Hans and Margarete Oppenheimer. Franz, a Hamburg-based lawyer and industrial, led since 1907 Emanuel Friedländer & Co., a coal wholesaler. The couple collected mice and porcelain, and like on a very high level. And in 1927, a catalogue was written for them by Julius Schnorr von Karelsfeld. The objects in this catalogue were thus certainly in the couple's collection already in 1927. In addition to the objects that we can link to the catalogue, another 91 inventory number from the Oppenheimer collection found their way into the possession of the Rijksmuseum via the Mannheimer collection. In 1937, Margarete and Franz Oppenheimer were forced to flee the country due to Nazi persecution and fled from Berlin to Vienna. After the Anschluss of Austria, they had to flee again via Budapest and Stockholm to the United States. The couple had to leave behind the largest part of their possessions in Berlin or Vienna, or they sold pieces under duress. The Oppenheimer objects, now in the Rijksmuseum, are likely sold under duress in Vienna by Franz Oppenheimer to Fritz Mannheimer, who might have done so to help him. Mannheimer is known to have stayed in a sanatorium in Vienna in the same year when Franz Oppenheimer was there. So we don't have an exact proof, but we can at least link them in the same city in the same time. Mannheimer must have acquired the 184 inventory numbers from Oppenheimer's collection after 1936 as well, so 37 is a likable year, since none of them are included in the collection catalog of von Falke. Another important source for acquisitions for Mannheimer was the international art market. Mannheimer bought from very well-known dealers like Seligman, Rosenberg, and he had harsh negotiations as well with Joseph Duveen. Here we see a picture of the Duveen office in Paris in Place Vendôme and a picture of Joseph Duveen. And we know that they had harsh negotiations because luckily the Duveen archive is now in the Getty and is digitized, so you can read all the correspondence between them. And for example, here we know that they had a really harsh discussion on a set of chairs. Mannheimer had this set on view in his home in the Hobbemastraat, but he wrote to Duveen that they were too large for his interior and he didn't want them. So then Duveen sent people to collect the chairs back. But then he wrote to a colleague at his company, "It appears that Mannheimer was furious and told the men he could not remove them and he would come to see us in Paris this week on the matter, so evidently there is still a chance if we reduce our price." And this you see a lot, this kind of discussions in this. Another great source are the former Russian collections. Between 1928 and 1933, over 24,000 objects were sold by the Russian state to foreign countries. The vast majority of them came from noble, church, or museum holdings that had been nationalized as a result of the revolution in 1917. Much of the nationalized objects were in the Hermitage, whether or not they were registered. Many objects, in particular from this museum and the Tsar's residences in and around Leningrad, now St. Petersburg, were sold. To facilitate this sale, Antiquariat was established. This kind of art dealer was in contact with Western dealers and individuals and sold vast amounts of art. The number of sales increased rapidly. In 1928, 858 objects left the country via Antiquariat, and in 1929, the number had already risen to 17,355. administration relating to these Russian sales had not been preserved, but in all likelihood was also never kept. Antiquariat was discontinued in 1935. Unsold objects were returned to the Hermitage until about 1937. Many of the objects sold by the Russian state in this period found their way into Dutch museums and private collections. It is likely that the Dutch buyers were aware of the Russian provenances. The precise provenances, however, are not documented in many cases, hence this information is lost. Various sources, such as the Duveen Archive again, indicate that Fritz Mannheimer acquired objects via the Paris branch of Antiquariat. And here on the picture we see the beautiful Cupid of Falconet, and it's again mentioned in the Duveen Archive, just as this clock where he writes, "This man has bought recently from the Russians the Falconet Cupid, garde à vous, for €1.25 million. He also acquired the Sèvres clock we wanted from Pavlovsk," and this clock is also in our collection now. "Unfortunately, it is not known whether some of the objects with a Russian provenance in the Mannheimer collection were acquired directly from Russia. Dealers who bought directly from the Russian state also offered objects for sale to Mannheimer. A good example is the dealer Sami Rosenberg, who bought many objects in Russia and frequently did business with Mannheimer. A third possibility is that Mannheimer acquired the object with a Russian provenance only much later, and that the pieces that were bought by dealers or private individuals from the Russian state subsequently circulated for years in the art market or in other collections. But this seems more unlikely given the above mentioned contact with Antiquariat." So, concluding, what were the results of our research? Actually, the results were, there were two groups that we really highlighted as possibly problematic, and we listed all the objects from the collection of Franz and Margarethe Oppenheimer as like unclear provenances and highlight them, and the one single object because we were sure it was in 1935 in the Goldschmidt Rothschild collection, but we also dedicated a whole chapter in our research report on the von Rothschild and Goldschmidt Rothschild objects to show that we did an extensive research on them. And this is where I come to the last part. What does it mean to be transparent and what does it mean to be open? And we can talk about this more, but I will tell you at least how we try to be transparent in where we stand with our research and how we show our results. On the Rijksmuseum website, on the research part, you have a section of provenance research, and here you also have a section about this Mannheimer research with, in the end, a link to the complete Mannheimer report that was also translated in English, so people from all over could read it. Besides that, what we do, not only for the objects within this specific Mannheimer research, but all our provenance work, we write a provenance sentence that is connected to each individual object on our website. So each object that has a provenance or that was in our research by our team gets a provenance sentence like this. And we are now also discussing with the board of directors that if we can even, and we will do that, if we can also put a sentence under it if it's like a problematic provenance, and highlight also all these problematic cases on our own website. We do this now as well on this website. It is actually the website from the Dutch Museum Society and this specific project within the parameters of which we do our research, the national project. So all the Dutch museums had to do provenance research, and they show their results and problematic cases on this website. And for example, this is a selection of objects that we have on that website that are for not from the Mannheimer collection, but for example, the Boetke salt cellars and a lot of paintings that we already researched. And the last thing I wanted to say is, I think there, it's good to think about what is true openness, because we are, in a sense transparent about our research results. We show what we do. We write on our website which group we are currently researching. But I think to be really open, you can go a step further and be active as a museum to approach the public to really tell the stories that you have unraveled in the research. Because I know, at least for the Jewish community in Amsterdam, they don't feel yet like there has been true recognition in a lot of cases. So how can you give recognition? And one way is to tell stories, make it visible for the public. So at the moment, we are working on several projects to enlarge this visibility, and one of them is changing the labels also on the objects that are permanently on display. And we are working together with the educational department and with the curators to, for example, now dedicate one room that is part of the permanent display with a lot of Mannheimer objects in it to Mannheimer, and also show with the Oppenheimer objects that are permanently on show to show their story. But of course, first we should contact the heirs in that case and also talk with them about what they think is important and what story they would like us to tell. So with that, no, there's one more thing I want to say. Another thing that's really important, especially when you don't have an archive like we had with the Mannheimer research, is that museums, archives, but also the archives of art dealers, should be open. Like, you should give access to researchers for research, and also try and digitize the sources as much as possible, because this is the only way we can continue to find out more. So on that note, I would like to conclude, and thank you very much for your attention and for coming tonight, and I will be very happy to answer your questions.